WIOX is supported by Mountain Flame in Arkville, featuring a range of products for home heating solutions. A variety of fireplaces, wood stoves, and gas and pellet stoves are available and on display. For sales and service, Mountain Flame in Arkville, warming home since 1980. Details at mountainflame.com. WIOX is supported by Music on the Delaware at the Walton Theater in Walton, New York, presenting Cherish the Ladies, singing and playing traditional Celtic music this Saturday evening. Open jam session upstairs at the theater at 6:30 and Cherish the Ladies concert at 7:30. Tickets and more information about Music on the Delaware at waltontheater.org or 607-865-6829. 607-865-6829.
Hello, hello. Nicole Bomer here, host of Blue Show, Something Old, Something Blue, every Wednesday night from 8 to 10, and classic rock show, Smokin' Saturdays, that happens alternate Saturday nights, also from 8 to 10. And you are listening to WIOX Roxbury, live and local in New York's Catskill Mountains at 91.3 FM, MTC Cable Channel 20, and WIOXradio.org.
Listening to WIOX Community Radio, live and local in the Catskill Mountains at 91.3 FM and MTC Cable Channel 20, and everywhere at WIOXradio.org, where it's easy to donate if you like what you hear. You can also get WIOX on any smart device through the FM radio apps. This is From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. John, how's it going?
I am well. How are you, Ryan?
I'm okay, John. What have you been up to?
Oh, well, I took a week off of work last week, and I spent the whole week in the woods.
No kidding.
So I spent it hunting with friends and family, and it was a very enjoyable week.
Yeah. Yeah, I got some hunting done myself, and let's just say there's more meat in the freezer, and that's good.
Us as well.
Well, tonight we got kind of a busy show tonight. It's Forest for Energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan. I'm not even going to attempt to say his last name. Dan and Sarah. And let me see if I can get them on. But first, Dan is an assistant professor of agricultural and biological engineering. He's also their academic program coordinator. His areas of expertise are bioenergy, biomass energy systems, thermochemical conversion, energy efficiency, controlled environment agriculture, solar energy resource evaluation. Jeez, man, it's a lot more than what I got. Then we got Sarah Wurzbacher, and she's the forestry extension educator at Pennsylvania State University, Also the Extension Silviculturalist in North Central PA with extension experience in forest management relative to wood heat. And her areas of expertise are forest ecology, health, structural forest habitat management, bioenergy and bioproduct, and biomass crops. Let me see if I can get them on. Hello. Hello, can you
hear
me?
Hey there.
Yes, how's it going?
Going great. Good to be here.
All right. Do I have both of you? We have Dan and Sarah on?
Yep. I think we're both here.
All right. All right, guys. So where are you guys calling in from?
Well, I'm at the Penn State University's main campus in a town called State College, Pennsylvania, right in the center of the state.
I'm a little closer to where you guys are. I'm calling from Williamsport, Pennsylvania. It's in the north central part of the state, and I'm currently in the local extension office. There's a Penn State Extension office in every county of the state in Pennsylvania, and I'm calling from the Lycoming County office.
Okay. What'd you say? Which county is Lycoming in?
So I'm in Lycoming County, but I'm in the city of Williamsport.
Gotcha. All right. Okay. So, introduction to biomass heating. How would you guys describe biomass, first of all?
Yeah, so my favorite definition is biomass is anything that's recently died that you can set on fire. But of course, that's a little bit tongue-in-cheek. But in general, what we're talking about when we talk about biomass is things that you've grown. We're really typically talking about plant material, whether it's herbaceous material or woody material. And definitely in the Northeast United States, in Pennsylvania, as well as New York, we're really talking primarily about wood as the biomass that's being used for energy.
And I really like Dan's definition. When I talk about biomass, I also talk about the fact that it's one of the energy sources that gives us the ability to use it as a solid fuel source for heat or for power, as a liquid fuel source. There's really every energy platform is accessible through a biomass feedstock.
And trees are most feasible, I guess?
Well, trees are definitely most common where we are. You know, Pennsylvania, over half of the land cover in Pennsylvania is forest. And I think New York is not too far off, probably pretty similar. And not only that, but there's an availability of wood that can be harvested and utilized on a sustainable basis. Right, Sarah?
Yeah, absolutely. This region wants to grow timber. That's really what it does really well. So our ability to use that resource for something we greatly need, energy, and use a resource that is renewable, that can regenerate and that we can use to provide other services is the most interesting aspect of it in this region, I think.
So other than wood, what other biomass energy sources are there?
Well, many people have probably heard about something called switchgrass, which a lot of people are really excited about as a biomass energy source. It's a perennial grass. It's a native prairie grass that is naturally found throughout the eastern and middle part of the United States. And it's a grass that grows very well, but in general, it doesn't have a lot of usefulness as, for example, an animal feed or for other purposes, but it can be used for biomass. And so there's been a lot of interest in trying to develop switchgrass as a biomass feedstock, in part because of all the other benefits that it provides to the ecosystem in a variety of ways.
Hey, Dan, before we go further, how do I say your last name? I'm not going to attempt to butcher it.
That's all right. It's pronounced Ciolkosz.
Oh, man. I would have really screwed that one up. Ciolkosz.
Yeah,
okay.
You picked two guests with incredibly strange last names for this episode here. So
okay.
Congratulations. Well done.
How do I say yours then, Sarah?
Oh, you did a great job.
Oh, good. All right.
Yeah.
I just wasn't going to attempt Dan's name, that's for sure. So if you're just tuning in to From the Forest, which is every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. with Ryan and John, tonight's topic is Forest for Energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan Ciolkosz and Sarah Wurzbacher. So, guys, New York State, we don't recognize currently woody biomass as a renewable resource. So you're telling me it's renewable?
Well, that's, you know, like so many things in life, What really depends on how is how you do it. If you do it well, it works well. If you do it poorly, it works poorly. And when it comes to biomass, the same is true. So I think the right answer to that question is biomass is renewable if you do it well. If you're growing it and producing it in a sustainable manner, if you're utilizing it in a sustainable manner, then it definitely is, in my viewpoint, a sustainable resource.
So I guess the question is, what does it mean to do it well?
Yeah, good question. Sarah, maybe you should talk about that from the forest management perspective first.
Yeah, so if we talk about my bread and butter is sustainable forest management. That's my jam. That's what I like to talk about. And when we talk about sustainable forest management, what we talk about is some type of management intervention that enables us to achieve the goals that we set for ourselves through that active intervention while maintaining the future potential of that stand or community of trees or landscape to continue providing services into the future. So that's a really broad scale brush here, but really we want to preserve the function of the forest while still utilizing the resource in the simplest possible terms.
And what's interesting is when I talk to...
You want me to get a little more specific?
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Would you like me to go a little more specific there, or is that kind of answer the question more broadly and we can kind of spend the rest of the time getting more detailed?
Yeah, no, if you want to get specific, let's do it. What are some examples of success where a forest is being managed, sustainably, which, that term can mean a lot of different things, I guess.
Yeah, so maybe it's best to in this region to talk about some examples of unsustainable management that are really, really common. And I dug a little bit into your show in the past, and I know you've talked a lot about what you call, quote, the consequences of doing nothing in your forests. So that's an issue here, too, where we see increasing forest health issues, invasive plant interference problems propping up all over the place, increasing fragmentation and development. Poor legacy planning when forests are handed off from person to person through generations. And most common in this region, my frame of reference is Pennsylvania, that's where I work, but across New England, the most common practice is high grading, essentially taking the best stuff out of the stand and leaving the rest behind. The trouble with that, the thought process behind that is, oh, the little trees will grow up. But as you know and as you've articulated in past programs, our forests are even-aged forests with complex structure. And so the future potential for those smaller stems is not really there. And there's a lower resiliency in that stand. There's a lowered ability to provide future services, to regenerate, to get back the species that are in the largest size classes that you're taking out. The smallest species in our forests overall are non-commercial hardwoods, black birch, beech, ash, red maple. And think about beech and ash, there's really limited future potential for those as sawtimber trees, whereas the biggest trees we're taking out, northern red oak, other oaks, red maple, black cherry, sugar maple, those are our biggest stems. If we focus on removing those, we may be removing a whole species from the system. And so that's kind of what makes it unsustainable. When we think about sustainable forestry, really the main thing is we want to have a plan. We want to plan ahead, and we want to preserve some of those things we want to preserve in the stand while removing some of the things that will enable those things that we leave behind to do better and thrive.
John, comments?
what first?
No, you go ahead, John.
Oh, you really covered a lot in a short amount of time. One of the first things that came to mind, though, is and you say that high grading is one of the biggest problems and one of those issues that's unsustainable, I guess is what Ryan first started to mention, is but what forces people to high grade? I mean, why is it even happening?
That's a good question. So I don't know what, statistically speaking, from surveys, why people high grade, but my guess from, talking to people is they often don't think in advance about what plans they have long-term for their forest. As foresters, we think about the very long-term in terms of, what's going to happen to this community of trees now and far, far into the future through what we call multiple rotations. But to a landowner, they look at an opportunity to harvest and make some money off of a stand, which is a laudable goal and one that foresters share. But they're thinking about it as one entry point in time. And so, of course, the largest stems and the nicest stems are the ones that really drive that economic decision. And so it's easy to kind of leave behind that other stuff. And I also think that landowners have a real interest in maintaining what they see as a healthy forest condition, meaning that there is forest there, but they don't think too much about what composes that forest. So when you do a high grade, you still see trees in front of you. You still see trees around you. And as a forester, you can look at that and say, this is degraded a little bit. But as a landowner, you say, well, at least I've still got some trees. And so I feel like that's part of it, certainly. But I'd really love to see more landowners that think far ahead about what they do with their forests. So, I mean, tomorrow's Thanksgiving. I'm going to make Thanksgiving metaphor here. So if you're cooking Thanksgiving dinner, you could just wake up and stick frozen turkey in the oven, and you're going to get some variable results, right? You'll probably still eat turkey, but I don't know how happy your guests will be with that, and I don't know if they'll come back the next year. But if you're going to do it right, you plan ahead. So you thaw out the turkey. I guarantee there's somebody peeling potatoes right now listening to this as they listen so that their day goes better tomorrow. And I think sustainable forest management is the same. So we build conditions that create success, and then we enjoy that profitable harvest that achieves our objectives and preserves options for the future.
Sarah, it's like we've had Mark Abrams on from Pennsylvania State University. Do you know him?
Yeah, I do.
And he's talked about the mesification and the densification of, you know, mostly Pennsylvania forest, but also the whole northeastern forest. How do you think that plays into the lack of doing nothing or mismanagement or whatever?
Yeah, so where we see high grading happen in oak hickory forests that are dominated by oaks and hickories and these stems, a lot of these stems that require higher light conditions, even, you know, black cherry, for example, in the northern hardwood system, Allegheny hardwood systems, where we have a lot of material that's left behind, it's hard to foster regeneration for species that are more light demanding, that grew up under different conditions than what we have now. So what you end up with is a lot of, well, if you're lucky, shade-tolerant hardwoods. And if you're very unlucky, you end up with ferns or black birch or beech brush or invasive plant species even that are kind of encroaching in and making it very hard to regenerate forests. On top of that, we have pretty high deer pressure across the region right now. So deer are browsing the stuff we like to see. And so overall, like, it's much harder to get back those more xeric forest species like oaks and hickories in those conditions. So the mesification of forests that Mark Abrams talks about really kind of centers on the fact that what can thrive in an environment like that? Red maple, because it's kind of a generalist, and a lot of other stuff that is, I suppose, more middling in terms of its availability to provide, like, hard mast or soft mast or structure or some of the other things that we really value or future timber potential. It all fits together, right? It's all part of the same system, and there's a lot of moving pieces, but our ability to better utilize that low-grade material might help us kind of turn back the clock a bit and create better conditions for those species we really want to foster.
Dan, I got a question for you. So combustion process, fuel choices, how does this whole process work? I mean, I know that people are probably saying, yeah, well, you just burn wood, right? So how does this process work most efficiently?
Sure, good question. But just as a bridge from what Sarah was saying, so the whole issue here is that combustion and wood heat, those systems can utilize these stems from the forest that are undesirable, that are invasive species, that are unmerchantable, that landowners desperately want to get out of their forest stands, but without wood heat as a market, they don't have a way of being able to pay for that. And so that's where this all connects in and hopefully can work well. So the question is, all right, so how does combustion work? What's the whole thing? So it's, you know, it's fun. It gets down to chemistry, which is always fun. I have to say that because my mom is a retired chemistry teacher, so I'm obligated to say good things about chemistry. And actually, it is kind of fun. But it's just a chemical reaction between your biomass and oxygen. It has to occur at high temperatures. And if you're combusting things completely, you're going to be producing water vapor, carbon dioxide, and then there will be some ash, some mineral ash that's left over as well. And so in the best of all worlds, that's what's happening. You're getting lots of heat, you're producing some water vapor and some carbon dioxide, which if you're managing your forest sustainably, that carbon dioxide ends up getting cycled back into the next generation of growth in your forest. However, if you have incomplete combustion, then you end up getting your smoke, your soot, things like that are being produced. You can get some hydrocarbons that are emitted into the air. And those are things that you don't want for two reasons. One is that you're missing out on the heat value of what's going up your chimney. And the second point is that it's not the sort of thing that you necessarily want to be breathing. It's not all that good for you. And so you have this interesting situation where high efficiency also means cleaner, and so you get this benefit here for in terms of economic and also ecological value of having wanting to make sure you have a nice high efficiency combustion system when you're using wood heat.
John, questions, so, comments?
What about the next thing? I mean, I see these gasifying stoves now. So, what part of combustion does that fit into?
Yeah, good question. So we're you know, technology is developing year after year. We're getting better at things, and it's the same thing is true of wood heat. It's not about using the Franklin stove from the 1700s. It's not even about using the wood stove that maybe was being sold a generation or two ago. Even though some of them are really tough and strong cast iron kinds of equipment that could run for another 100 years maybe, it's really a good idea to take a look at what's being manufactured and sold now, because you're going to be able to get a lot more heat out of the same amount of wood, and it's going to burn a lot cleaner. And so there are several things that people are looking at. One of them is gasification. And what's interesting there is that system works by heating up the biomass to the point where it breaks down to gases. But you heat it up without any oxygen in that environment. So you have this mixture of gases. It's usually carbon monoxide, some methane, some hydrogen. And then those gases are burnt as a gas, similar to the way you would burn natural gas in a natural gas furnace. And so that has potential to be very efficient, and also to leave behind the ash, so you get less ash that goes up the chimney in the process. But there are a lot of other things that people look at. You know, catalytic stoves have been on the market for a while now, where they're using special chemistry to break down uncombusted compounds before they get a chance to escape up the chimney. Another important thing that newer stoves use a lot of is to make sure that the gases in the stove stay hot for a long enough period of time so that they can combust completely, because they need to be in that hot zone for over a second, close to a second and a half, if they're going to combust completely. And older stoves typically didn't do that, which is why they tended to be lower efficiency. They tended to be a little more smoky. The thing that's coming over the horizon and is going to be really important for meeting some of these new EPA guidelines for efficiency for stoves is actually the use of oxygen sensors in the exhaust gas. And let me back up a little bit. Traditionally, we have dampers that we manually control on a wood stove in a home, and it's lots of fun to play around with the knob, but the bottom line is it's really tough to tell whether we're giving it too much air or too little air. If we give it too much air, then we're losing heat up the chimney. If we give it too little air, then we're choking down the fire, and it's going to end up putting soot and things like that up the chimney instead. And so an oxygen sensor can very accurately detect whether we're providing enough air or not, and then automatically adjust those dampers so you're getting exactly the amount of air that's needed to optimize the combustion conditions in your stove.
Dan, what kind of oxygen sensor are we talking about here?
what kind of oxygen sensor?
Yeah, like how expensive is this going to be? Don't price us wood stove guys out.
Is this going to require a state inspection now, like my car?
Oh, no.
That's a really good, it's the same, basically the same kind of sensor you might see in a car, oxygen sensor, you know, and so there are a lot of them around. They're being mass produced. It shouldn't be too expensive, and you're right. That's something I worry about, too, the whole idea of it being priced out so that all of a sudden your stove isn't worth it economically. The other thing I worry about is one of the neat things about stoves is that they work whether you've got power or not.
Right.
And when you've got electronics involved, then how's that going to work? And I think it's going to be an important thing for stove manufacturers to keep that in mind and try to make sure that these stoves still operate. Maybe, you know, if you have a power outage, because at least for me, I like the idea of being able to know that I'm going to be able to heat up my coffee and my oatmeal and things like that in the morning if there's no power.
Dan, here's a simple question for you. Bark on or off if you're burning wood? I'm burning wood right now, and I take the bark off. Is that a good thing?
Yeah. Well, you know, I work at a university, so my answer to most questions is it depends. And we love saying that to all questions. And actually, that really is the right answer to give to a question like that. In general, bark burns fine, but it has more ash to it. You know, most of the ash in a trunk is going to be in the bark. And so when you have the bark, when you include the bark in with your wood, you're going to have a lot more ash. You're going to have to be shoveling your ash out more often, things like that. If that's an issue for you, then you want to take the bark off, use the bark for something else. But if that's not a problem, my personal preference is to keep the bark in and utilize it and get every last bit of potential energy and value out of that wood.
So, Dan, what are the fuel sources that wood comes in? I mean, we know cordwood. What else is there?
Right. So cordwood, of course, is the big one that most people use. Probably the next most common would be wood pellets. And that's pretty popular in Pennsylvania and throughout the Northeast as a heating fuel. It really came about as wood processors began to try to find uses for leftover sawdust in the sawmills. And so they adapted the equipment that was being used to make feed pellets for farm animals and to use that to pelletize the sawdust. And after a few years of tinkering, they kind of worked it out and they produced these pellets, and that gave rise to this whole wood pellet industry. And so wood pellets are more uniform than cordwood. They burn more regularly. The stoves tend to be higher efficiency. But there's something, they lose a little bit of that romance. There's something about putting a log on the fire and watching it burn that you don't quite get from a pellet stove. But I hear people who get tired of doing a lot of chopping and splitting and carrying, they often will switch from cordwood to pellets as you get older and you get tired of doing all that work out back. That's a common transition that people do. Those are the two main forms of wood fuel for homeowners. When you start looking at bigger facilities, when it's schools, hospitals, commercial facilities, then you typically are looking at wood chips being sold and utilized as a fuel. And we have a lot of schools in Pennsylvania, up through New York, New England, other places that will utilize wood chips, and they're pretty common. They can be wood chips coming from a sawmill. They can be wood chips coming from a forest stand improvement activity, and they feed them into a large boiler that burns them very efficiently and then turns that into either hot water or steam that's used to heat the facility.
Go ahead.
Oh, I just want to mention, too, you know, we talk about kind of the end user, but in the wood processing world, you know, a lot of mills will use residues from processing to heat kilns, too, you know, and that's old news for them. But, you know, what Dan's talking about is really just kind of adapting that at a commercial scale for schools and hospitals and so forth. So there's a long tradition of using wood for heat within the industry and for the end user as well.
So I'm speaking with Sarah and Dan from Pennsylvania State University about forests for energy. And how significant is low-grade, meaning biomass, wood chips, cordwood, etc., in Pennsylvania?
You mean as a heat source?
Yeah, like, hey, do you know, because I realize this data is kind of hard to get, so I'm not expecting an answer, but I know in New York State, if you have less than 65,000 people in a county, they don't even put you into the, they don't even tally you. So do you know how significant it's being used, like cordwood or any one of these sources in PA?
Yeah, Dan might have some numbers on that.
Yeah, you're putting me on the spot. I'd have to dig around a little bit to find some numbers. It's not a major source of heat in Pennsylvania in general, but in rural Pennsylvania, it's definitely significant. So it's really location specific. When you get into the major metropolitan areas, the Philadelphia, the Pittsburgh, places like that, not really. And of course, since that's where most of the people are living, then it kind of gets washed out when you do statewide statistics. But if you start to take a look at the rural areas, smaller towns, it really is a pretty significant part of the overall energy picture for folks, in part because natural gas, which is very popular in the cities, is not really readily available in the country. And so it's really going to be either biomass or one of the deliverable forms of fossil fuels, things like fuel oil or propane.
Yeah, and so across New England, too, you know, it also depends on what the legacy fuel has been, right? So there's a larger adoption toward away from fossil fuels and toward biomass in New England because majority of residential systems are oil systems, which are quite pricey right now, versus, you know, where gas is available in PA, you know, you're likely to want to hook up to gas. It's price is right on that right now. But in New England, it's relatively easy to retrofit biomass to replace a heating oil system, and we see a lot more adoption of that up there at the residential scale.
If you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. Tonight's topic is forests for energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan Ciolkosz and Sarah Wurzbacher. And up next, we got more questions for them about comparing wood energy to other fuel sources and forest management implications. But we're going to take a break, and we'll ask some more after the break.
Well, you know, last winter spent a million at two. He my house with that bubble and crude black gold. OPEC oil. So I thought I'd get smiling others before. And I went out and I got me a stove, a wood-burning stove that can burn coal. No, I went right out and I bought me a saw, an axe and a wedge and a big heavy maul. And I took to them woods, trucking off. Now the first tree I cut was a big old tree. It came crashing down with a big heavy thud. And I look at that tree lying on the ground. And I saw before my eyes a crackling glow. And I felt the warmth of a wood-burning stove. And I said, hey, now let's move. I'm burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood. Cut up the tree and piled it on the truck. Brought it home to split it up. Get it nice and seasoned before the winter comes. Now swing an axe and swing them all. Pile your wedge and swing it some more. Working up a thirst, just working the wood. I'm burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood. And my pants are torn. All this work just to stay warm. Well, I hardly think it's worth it at all. Then I see that oil truck standing tall. Then back out in the woods and oh yeah, I'm cutting more. Cause I'm burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
Burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
gets mighty cold, I'm gonna be sitting by my wood-burning stove, keeping nice and warm, just my honey and me. And I'll drink my beer and sing a little song, waiting for spring when it's gonna get warm. Cause hella high water this winter, I sure won't freeze. Cause I'm burning wood,
burning wood,
burning wood,
burning wood.
I'm burning wood.
I'm burning wood,
and I'm staying nice and warm, just burning wood.
All right, if you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. Tonight's topic is Forests for Energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan Ciolkosz and Sarah Wurzbacher. All right, so is burning wood really dirty? There's a lot of talk about pollution and emissions from burning wood, and you talked a little bit about it, but I'm sure someone wants to know about the particulate matter.
Yeah, great question. But if it's all right, I just want to back up because you caught me flat-footed on this question about how much of Pennsylvania's energy comes from wood. So while that great song was playing, I pulled up some numbers here. And by my reckoning, we're looking at about 1.5% of Pennsylvania's energy use comes from wood. And we probably could easily quadruple that without having to make significant changes to our forest management or developing woody energy crops and things like that to meet demand.
I mean, so here in the Catskill region, a lot of our woody biomass gets left in the woods. I'm sure there's not much different in Pennsylvania, at least in places.
Yeah, that's exactly the situation. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a good segue, John. Sarah. Is it bad or good to leave stuff on the forest floor? You want to clean it up like a nice tidy pasture, or what do you want to do?
Oh, you just you know me. You just set me up so I can hear you smiling while you ask that question. But first, maybe I want to give Dan a chance to answer this question about pollution and emissions. I don't want to jump over him.
All right, so I'll try to be quick about it, but while I'm an enthusiast about wood heat, and I think it's great, you have to acknowledge that emissions and air quality is, if there's one downside you have to be careful about with wood heat, it is emissions, especially with older equipment that's less efficient. But even with higher efficiency equipment, you have this issue of what's called particulate matter. So you get very fine particulates. It's basically very small bits of ash, fly ash, that's too small to stay in the stove, that gets pushed up into the air. And that ash, those particulates, can be a health issue, especially in areas where there's a dense population, maybe you have a lot of stoves burning, things like that. So it's something that you definitely have to be thinking about, have to be cognizant of when you're choosing to go with wood heat. In rural areas where the population spread out a little bit more, is probably not so much of a concern, but it is something to think about, and I don't want to downplay or minimize that issue, especially in the larger areas, especially in valleys where you may get these inversion layers where emissions can kind of just sit down in the valley on those quiet mornings, and it doesn't get dispersed very, very effectively.
Dan, is it carbon neutral? You know people are going to ask that.
Yeah, great question, and it depends on how you define your analysis and how you how you set up the problem. You know, it's basically the question is, what answer do you want to get, and based on that, how shall we set up the question? But in general, I have to believe that if you're taking good care of the forests and the forests are regenerating and growing in the long term, then your use of that wood for energy is carbon neutral in the long term. And it's tough to argue against that, in my book, at least.
So, yeah, and there have been some pretty in-depth investigations in eastern forests that look at carbon stocks under different types of management scenarios. And comparing different types of thinnings, thinning small stuff, thinning large stuff, doing what we would consider sustainable even age management, where you're taking a lot of material out. Really, what's supported over and over again is that the best carbon potential in the long term over multiple rotations really comes when we're doing sustainable forest management and getting good regeneration. And so a number of those studies have been spearheaded by the Forest Service, and they really support what Dan has been saying. So if we consider also where the carbon stocks are in forests, you know, about half of it is in the live trees. A very small percentage of it, probably less than about 5%, is in deadwood, standing and down deadwood. And the rest of it is in the soils and in the forest floor, in the litter. So, you know, the trees are really only part of the equation. And so as long as we're maintaining that healthy forest condition that is growing, that big carbon stock in the soil is still going to be there, too. So that's something just to think about.
Okay, so most people probably don't even think about the soils as part of the forest.
Yeah, it's under everything, literally and figuratively.
Sarah, here's a question. Is younger forest or older forest better for carbon storage? Do you know the answer to that?
That's a hotly contested question, and it really depends. Dan said he loves to use the phrase, it depends, and I like to one-up him by saying it depends and it's complicated. The rate of growth in younger forests is really high, but large stems that are growing slowly, you know, they put on, they're the huge, when you look at a tree and it's, you can't put your arms around it, that tree puts on a lot of carbon every year, right? So I don't have numbers on that. I'd have to dig around on a commercial break and look for that. But certainly what we want in terms of forest health across the landscape is a variety of age classes, where we have some young forests that are really rapidly growing and rapidly accruing carbon, some middle-aged forests that are maturing that we can kind of tend toward healthy conditions, and mature forests that we can either push into old-growth conditions or regenerate back into young forest conditions. And having a variety of those across the landscape is really the goal that we want. And they all accrue carbon at different rates, but they all accrue carbon.
John, you have any questions?
I guess the whole time you were talking, I was thinking about the wildlife benefits too. You know, you can't just be thinking about the forest and the trees. There's other things incorporated as well, and having that mix of uneven age classes and forest ages is all adds to it.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, as we say, like, energy and the potential to use the resource for biomass energy is really just one of the objectives that we have for forest management, and it's really just one tool that we have in reaching our other objectives for forest management. And so previously you asked me a question about the function of course, woody debris and deadwood in forests. And since you brought up wildlife, you know, certainly what makes a tree not a suitable saw timber tree? Maybe it has a defect, like a big cavity in it, but that's a great wildlife feature. That's something we want to retain in the landscape. Deadwood is used by a huge number of wildlife species, small mammals. It supports a really healthy and resilient forest condition, and those are features we want to keep around, whether they're standing snags or down debris, you know, as long as the standing snags aren't presenting a hazard to us. The other thing about debris when we are talking about a harvest scenario is that sometimes when we leave slash around after we harvest, it kind of protects regeneration a little bit from deer browse, and it's one of the easier ways, you know, without the expense of putting up a fence or doing like a really heavy deer pressure through hunting on a site. It's one way that we can kind of provide a little bit of cagey-type protection from deer browse. The other thing is, if you have mechanized equipment that's driving over the tops from trees, there's a little bit of a reduction in impact and in the soil's impact. And, of course, tops and fine woody debris, as well as some of the smaller coarse woody debris, is important for nutrient cycling in the future of the stand. But the truth is that a lot of that material can come out of the forest and be used for biomass without detrimental effect in terms of the residual stand.
Hey, if you're just tuning in, you're listening, you're missing a good show here on From the Forest. Tonight's topic is Forest for Energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan Ciolkosz and Sarah Wurzbacher. Dan, comparing wood energy to other fuel sources, how does it stack up?
Nothing is as nice as sitting in front of a warm wood stove, watching the flames lick up, feeling your shins heat up, and deciding whether you need to shift position so another part of your body gets warmed or overwarmed. It's just the way, that's, nothing can beat that, aesthetically. So I just wanted to say that straight out. That's one of the most wonderful things about, and the fact that you have this kind of connection to the forest through the way that you're heating yourself. There's just something neat about that, at least for me, and I think a lot of people really enjoy that. Wood heat generally requires a little more effort on a person's part, especially if you're going out and cutting your own wood, right? The old joke is that it heats you twice. It heats you when you cut it, and then it heats you again when you burn it later on. But also just maintaining and operating your equipment, it's not automatic, right? A natural gas or boiler, you press a button and you probably can forget about it for several years and nothing will happen. But if you forget about your wood stove, it'll burn down and the fire will burn down in a few hours, and you need to keep after that regularly. And so that's a big thing to keep in mind for folks. And that's the biggest difference in general between wood heat and most fossil fuels, is that. Now, pellet stoves and pellet boilers, they can be much more automated where they can run for multiple days or even more, you know, multiple weeks, depending on how large your in-feed equipment is. So it is possible to automate it more and more and make it more trouble-free. But in general, we're looking at having to spend more attention to your heat and to your heating system if you're using wood.
And what about, why is wood so stable? I mean, it's remained pretty stable, right? The price of a cord of wood compared to these other sources, how come?
Yeah, that's kind of fascinating, and I think it's just because the market for fossil fuels is impacted by politics. It's impacted by, you know, international issues. It's there are futures traders that are kind of fiddling around with futures prices and things like that going on all over the place. But when it's wood, it's usually somebody that you know down the road that's gonna show up with a pickup truck load of wood and gonna dump it in your driveway. There are a lot fewer players in that whole supply chain that have the potential to kind of mess with things. And I think at the bottom, the simplicity is what makes the market so much more stable than other energy sources.
John?
Well, and plus with wood, I mean, it seems like if you're living in an area in a forest, you know, mostly forested area, there's always somebody willing to give away wood somewhere, somehow. Yeah, come cut it off my property, or yeah, I have a tree that blew over, whatever. You can't get that. You can't get that with oil and gas. You know, there's no one that's going to give it away ever. So that affects price too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I always love driving around the neighborhood, seeing who's cutting a tree down, and seeing if they'd like me to cart pieces away, things like that. There's often opportunities. You can think of it as an opportunity fuel to a certain degree, or at least a portion of what you're getting could be thought of as an opportunity fuel. Yeah.
So, Dan, you're a fellow wood pirate, huh?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
All right. My kind of people.
My passion, everything.
Sarah. What is some things you wish people knew about silviculture? And I guess you'd have to define what that word means first.
Boy, silviculture, as I define it when I talk to landowners and folks, is if we think of agriculture as responsibly tending crops and rural landscapes to produce something that we need, silviculture is the tree version of that. It's our ability to kind of foster conditions that we can use the ecology of the system to guide it in the direction we want to go to achieve the objectives that we want. So when we talk about silviculture for timber management, we want to use the underlying ecology of the species that are in the community of trees to ultimately get where we want to go, to produce sawlogs out of a timber harvest, while preserving the ability to regenerate that stand or community of trees back to a condition that we like and want to use again in the future. So in my definition, it's using the ecology of the stand to get what we need done. And so what I wish people knew about silviculture is how complex that interaction between all of those different species really can be. On the face of it, harvesting trees seems really simple, but there's a lot we can do to kind of move things in the right direction and do management sustainably. And for the sake of our conversation today, the number one thing I want people to know is that smaller trees or more poorly formed trees left in the woods don't quite provide the same service that those largest trees that they've taken out, if they've done a high grade, might have provided. And that they're also kind of missing opportunities to do interesting types of management, and that they can really achieve anything they want. If they want to do something for wildlife, want to do future saw timber potential, whatever, silviculture can get you there as long as you have the initial condition present.
How does the time scale between silviculture versus agriculture affect people's opinions on the practices?
Yeah, it's a huge part of it, right? So in agriculture, you can do something every year, and there's a lot of seasonal stuff that you can do, right? And for these large structural, big impact kind of things we do in our forests, it might happen once every 60 years. It could happen on a smaller time scale, depending on the type of management you're doing, but we're talking about decades. And if we think about long-term management planning, we're thinking about centuries, right? We're thinking about the very, very long-term trajectory. And we're also thinking about much larger scales on the landscape, too. And so I think it's tough for people to kind of independently, as individuals, think about that in a productive way, which is always why it's a good idea to create a relationship, a long-term relationship with a forester who can consult with you and help you build that management plan based on what he or she knows about the ecology of the system to move you in that right direction.
If you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest. Tonight's topic is Forest for Energy with Pennsylvania State University's Dan Ciolkosz and Sarah Wurzbacher. Dan, what are some things you wish people knew about wood energy and wood energy systems in general?
I think the whole idea of how wood energy can make the forests better is a really important story to tell that a lot of people don't appreciate. And even me, there are times when I have these aha moments, like when I was talking with one of our state forest managers, and she was talking about her specific area of the forest and talking about, oh, yeah, we need to clear out these certain weed trees out of this area and this other area. And I just kind of, I don't know why I didn't realize this, but I just realized she's thinking about this forest the way I think about my patch of vegetables at home, except that she doesn't pick tomatoes every year. She harvests trees every 60 or 70 years. And so when you're using wood heat, you're providing a means for the foresters to get rid of the weeds. And when you realize that, you realize that there's a potential to have this really good benefit on the forest, provide a really cost-effective, low-cost heat for your home, and in some ways potentially just enhance the quality of your life by having that connection to it. We haven't talked a lot about the relative costs, and I just want to mention that here we've put together a little online tool that makes it easy for you to figure out what the relative cost would be for if you're trying to compare heating oil to wood pellets or to cordwood or something like that. And folks can pull that off the internet if they like. They can just do a search for online energy selector tool. And they'll see that on the Penn State Extension website. It's a little spreadsheet file, and it has some clear instructions on how to use it. So it'd be a very easy way for them to take a look and say, well, if I'm paying a certain amount per gallon for propane, but I could switch to cordwood at a certain other price, would I be saving money or not? And it helps them answer that question.
Well, believe it or not, we only have 3 minutes left on From the Forest. And here's a question for both of you. What are some examples of success, I guess?
Examples of success. Yeah, so what I love to talk about is some of these new schools, especially in Pennsylvania, that have been installing wood heating systems that heat their schools. These are large computer controlled, very, very efficient, very clean burning things that are saving on the orders of, you know, $100,000 a year for these school districts. And what's interesting is the students are thrilled about it. They're excited about that. They see these things. They think it's really exciting. They want to learn more. They want to be part of this kind of thing. They want to work and take care of this kind of equipment and do this for a living. And that's really neat to see this kind of benefit where people get excited about using the forest in a sustainable manner where they weren't excited before.
And I'll talk about two different systems that we've seen biomass enable a silvicultural solution in a stand that we really weren't sure what to do with. So in one example, this happened in two different systems that I'm aware of in northern Pennsylvania, one in the Allegheny National Forest, where they did a weight-scaled sale. Normally in forestry, we sell by volume, but they're selling by weight and doing whole tree harvesting, which is kind of a non-traditional approach to remove beech interference. So in the mid-canopy, there's this dense structure of beech, and I'm sure you're very familiar with this condition in New York as well, where they felled everything down to an inch. Normally they would remove everything that they fell, but they removed everything 4 inches and up and left some of the other stuff on the site to mitigate soil impact of machinery. And their ability to do that because of a ready market enabled them to deal with that beech interference problem without the enormous expense of doing herbicide applications. And in one case, in the Bradford Watershed, in a very similar system, these were both first entry shelter wood cuts, so they were going to go back and continue cutting. They were only able to do that because there was a market right there in place that was ready to take that material. So because of that market, that management got done and that stand improved, regeneration improved in that stand. And in another situation where we have stands that are very degraded by forest health issues, by emerald ash borer, by beech bark disease, hemlock woolly adelgid, other types of forest health issues, where there's really not enough saw timber to go in and economically and defensively do some type of large-scale management, where there is a biomass market in place, managers were able to go in there, clear out the area a bit, and opportunistically release patches of regeneration that were then able to compete really well because they suddenly had light. Without that market, they wouldn't have been able to do that. So there's a couple of situations in which having somewhere to burn that material enabled directly much better forest management to take place.
Well, unfortunately, we are out of time, and thank you guys for coming on tonight. We really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
All right. Thanks so much for coming on. And up next is Mostly British with Rick Neblong. And have a good night and happy Thanksgiving.
Good night, everyone.
All right. Good night, guys.
From the forest, his tears fell on the sidewalk as he stumbled in the street. A dozen faces stopped to stare, but no one stopped to speak. For his castle was a hallway, and the bottle was his friend. And the old man stumbled in from the forest. Up a dark and dingy staircase, the old man made his way. His ragged coat around him as upon his cot he lay. And he wondered how it happened that he ended up this way. Getting lost like a fool in the forest. And as he lay there sleeping, a vision did appear. Upon his mantle shining the face of one so dear, who'd loved him in the springtime of a long forgotten year, when the wildflowers did bloom in the forest. She touched his grizzled fingers and she called him by his name. And then he heard the joyful sound of children at their games. In an old house on a hillside in some forgotten town,
where the river runs down from the forest.
Manicures and pedicures, fitness and yoga classes. Details at 845-688-2828 or emersonresort.com. WIOX.